I'm going to take questions now. It would be very helpful if those catching my eye could identify yourselves and the organisations you represent. Gentleman in the back, you were first.
Okay. Well, I'm John Wilton. I'm here in a private capacity. You asked who could have foreseen Russia's actions in Ukraine in 2013. I'd suggest it goes a little bit further back. Ukraine wasn't the first victim of the current round of Russian belligerence, and Russia still occupies large areas of Georgia. Do you think there's a danger we're going to forget about Georgia and focus on Ukraine?
No, absolutely right. And Georgia, 2008, held up a mirror, I think, which certainly from a NATO perspective and the West perspective, was largely ignored. And there's no question, as you say, that phase one is Georgia. And actually, I remember being in Georgia in 2013, and at that stage, the Georgians were very concerned that Putin would do something around about the time of the Sochi Winter Olympic Games, which of course he did, although it was not in Georgia. Is there a danger that Georgia should be forgotten? No, I don't think there's a danger of Georgia being forgotten. And certainly from a NATO perspective, Georgia has demonstrated that it is a most valued partner. Georgian soldiers played a key role in ISAF, occupying, taking part in some very heavy fighting and took heavy casualties in Helmand. The Georgian military contribution to NATO missions in Afghanistan then, and indeed the training mission now, is significantly out of proportion to the size of the Georgian armed forces and the Georgian population. The challenge, of course, is NATO membership, and that's the sort of the elephant in the room, the promise of NATO membership to both Ukraine and Georgia in 2013. I think the prospects of that happening while Russia occupies a significant proportion of Georgian sovereign territory are a matter for, frankly, off the table until that issue is resolved. But I know that certainly from my time in NATO, and I've no doubt it continues, that that the alliance will continue to find ways to look for ways to support Georgia, and more politically, more broadly, the same I'm sure applies in Europe.
General Lev.
Thank you. Thank you very much, General Ewan Grant, former law enforcement intelligence analyst. I managed to catch the last copy of the paperback on the Tesco shelves and was very pleased to see that they did restock it a few days later. They didn't last long either. I've seen at first hand in dealing with civilian law enforcement agencies in Ukraine about how their reasonable expectations of cooperation with EU member states and the EU as a whole haven't always been met, which is perhaps an understatement. In that context, who's listening to you in the West, and perhaps more importantly, who isn't?
Well, I think others have to judge that. I think there is a general sense, though, of increasing concern and foreboding about the threat posed by Russia, the dynamics started with the invasion of Crimea and eastern Ukraine. And that's reflected, I think, widely, whether it's the RAND report on the security of the Baltic states, a number of other think tank papers highlighting the threat, the Atlantic Council report on what support should be given to Ukraine, and more widely. I think the question is whether the sort of action is being done. And I have to say that there is good sign of it. I mean, the enhanced forward presence in the Baltic states is clear. That's a good sign. But I don't think that there is that sense among the general population of real concern, which is going to translate into really bold political action, which perhaps there was during the years of the Cold War. And I think particularly in the UK, as we have to focus increasingly on the challenges posed by the referendum and the decision to come out of Europe and the complexities of that disentanglement, we need to keep the flame alive and compare the challenges and threats.
Can I just add a right? We're not leaving Europe, generally. We're leaving the EU. There is a fundamental difference, if I could just point that out. Gentlemen now.
Jonathan Bodel, I'm the chief exec of a charity called Hope Now that's been working in Ukraine for 25 years. We work in similar areas to the British Ukrainian Aid, healthcare, working with children, working with vulnerable adults and the elderly. We support many of the hospitals there too. One of the biggest issues we've had is actually the transfer of funds. Ukrainian banks have been somewhat notorious in withholding some of our monies, which has meant until 6 months ago, most of the funds I took was in my pocket or in my wife's pocket to take, and we would give it directly to various folk. Is there some way in which, as a larger group of organisations, we can work more closely with some Ukrainian folk, Ukrainian banks, people where we know the money's going to go to the right place? For example, with the army, I was requested at Christmas to buy a vehicle so that they could bring back the dead from the east of the country back to the towns where they come from, which we did. But that money was given directly to an army major. He bought the vehicle and I handed him the keys. Dealing with the bureaucracy out there, I know we've all dealt with it and have to continue to do so, has been a major issue, and it's stopping funds getting through.
I mean, I'm afraid I note that there's quite a significant team from the Ukrainian embassy here, and I think this is a matter which needs to be picked up by the Ukrainian authorities. This is way outside my there may be other people here who can comment on it as well.
If anyone would be willing to speak to me later, I'd be very grateful.
Can we just ask anybody from the embassy, do you want to comment on that?
Thank you for your question, and I think we can cooperate and communicate about this issue. On behalf of the embassy, we will be ready and our opponent to facilitate the organization.
Thank you so much.
If I may emphasize, it's really important if people are going to give their time and their money to helping those Ukrainians who are suffering in the East, it is very important that the Ukrainian government should give them every possible assistance. And please could you take that message back to Her Excellency the Ambassador. Thank you. Next question. Gentleman over there.
Yes. I'm a retired music lecturer.
Retired music lecturer?
Yes.
Marvellous. Are you going to sing to us?
First one is that given the current situation in Ukraine, the government is expanding on a legal coup, a violent coup. The second point is that America said, have you responded to the fact that America spent $5 billion on one of the Taliban regimes, not throwing that religion to the government in the Ukraine? And the third point is, what are your comments upon that telephone conversation of Victoria Nuland from the American government on their who they were instituting into the new government after the coup?
And your question is?
Yes, what's it? Please answer your question.
Well, I think you raise a couple of political comments or points rather than questions, and as far as comments on my views on Victoria Nuland's telephone conversation, I haven't read the transcript of the conversation, so I'm not really in a position to comment.
Next question, lady over there.
Obviously, the Russian side. So, Russia only recognizes strength, especially only recognizes power, especially when it comes to direct confrontation. Do you think there are any effective measures to put additional pressure on Russia, especially in regard to its actions in eastern Ukraine?
Ultimately, this has got to be resolved politically through discussion, through negotiation, but from a position of strength. And through an understanding that international law has got to be recognized. And I fear that until there is a recognition by Russia of international law and the sovereign rights of Ukrainian borders, it's very difficult to see how that impasse can be broken unless there's a significant change of opinion in the Russian leadership.
Well, do you think is there any effective way to make that right? They're now playing this
Well, let's look what, be optimistic for a moment. I mean, there may be an opportunity with the arrival of a new president in Washington. That might just provide a chance to break an impasse. And if that's the case, that would be great. I mean, Mr. Trump has promised he'd be prepared to do deals. He's a great deal maker. But I think I'd say that he's got to do it from a position, I come back to, he's got to be done from a position of strength, because if it's done from a position of weakness, and I think the West is weak in this respect, there's only going to be one winner in this deal-making process.
Any other questions? Gentleman there.
Yeah.
Dave?
Obviously, America has a headache in NATO, so I promise about taking NATO seriously. I think you will. The key problem is that we're going to try to like live after disappointed by NATO performance and having fun that unfacts it or I will American fight. On the wide point, what would probably want to be made to Russia on the issue of Syria, which is perhaps a little more prominent than the issue. What do you think our money needs? What do you think our money needs in NATO to be in Europe if I'm going to consider it first?
I think I'd push back on disappointment with NATO in Afghanistan. Yes, there was perhaps a gap between the commitments or the challenge of finding the necessary force levels, or that was a challenge. But nevertheless, actually, the ISAF mission, for all the continuing challenges of Afghanistan, and the international community needs to remain there for some time in order to see this through, actually did what it said on the tin. And for an alliance of 28 nations with 22 partner nations to come up with a strategy at the Lisbon summit in 2010, and then to implement that strategy in sufficiently so that the sufficiently well, and it's a, you know, at least it was a 60 or 80, 70% solution, not necessarily 100%, to be able to hand over sovereignty to the and responsibility for security to the Afghans by the end of the ISAF mission in a reasonable way, notwithstanding the continued need for training and support in other ways, actually is not a bad result. I think the question of Syria or Eastern Europe is an interesting one, because I think it highlights the extent to which we in the West tend to look at these in stovepipes or silos, whereas I'm sure that Mr. Putin, who I do think has a strategy and I do think strategically, sees it as all part of an overall strategy to put Russia into a place where Russia is in his view, once again respected as a great power and as the power broker. And he's achieved that in Syria, in spades. He is the power broker in Syria, and he's marginalized the West, marginalized America. And if Mr. Trump is to make a regain there, again, it's going to take time, effort, and again, it's got to come from a position of strength. But I think in terms of prioritizing, one is a case of containment of chaos. The other is a case of deterring potential catastrophe. And for all the ghastliness of the Syrian civil war and the terrible suffering and humanitarian disaster and what we've seen with Aleppo, and the impact of the refugee crisis and the impact of Islamic of Daesh terrorism and the like. And this may sound pretty harsh, but actually this is not an existential threat, whereas the potential for a miscalculation leading to war is existential. We would not be sitting here in room committee room 6 if there is a war with Russia, because Russia integrates nuclear weapons into every aspect of their military thinking. They practice, train, and are prepared to use them. So I think the priority must be to establish security in effective deterrence, but that doesn't mean, and I'm going to do what I hear on the one hand, on the other hand, answer here, that does not mean that America should not seek to re-establish its relevance and its usefulness as a power broker in the Middle East as well.
Gentleman there was next, and then the young lady.
Thank you. And Kruger has skipped possibility as a student in Scottish Lab. My question is about economical sanctions. How do you assess their role in an attempt or as a tool to influence Russian behavior and stop it?
I think they're the only effective weapon that could be used. I think they're really important. But it's a double-edged weapon. And yes, clearly, they have had a significant impact on the Russian economy. Sanctions have always been a double-edged weapon, and there are plenty of examples, though, where they've ultimately worked. And you could say that the Iranian deal may well have been influenced by sanctions. I'm sure it was. The concern, of course, is the weakening of the Russian economy, which results from sanctions and from low oil prices. I think an economically weak Russia is an even more dangerous Russia. Because I think my concern would be that Mr. Putin recognizes that time is running out, that his position is in jeopardy. He needs to maintain high popularity ratings, the sort of popularity ratings we saw after Crimea, the sort of ratings we saw after the intervention into Syria. And at a time when the Russian population may well be finding life increasingly difficult, the concern is that he turns to the traditional remedy of an autocrat facing trouble at home, which is foreign interventions. But fundamentally, I think sanctions remain the one weapon that the West can continue to apply against Russia, to put the sort of pressure on in order to change mindsets in Moscow and potentially open up the possibilities that our other questioner highlighted about what's going to change things in attitudes.
Young lady.
I work for a human rights NGO. My question is about whether dialogue with Russia is actually possible on both the military level and the legal level. So on the military front, seeing as they clearly haven't respected ceasefires such as the Minsk Protocol during the Battle of Debaltseve, is it possible to actually come to an agreement and to trust that they will do what they say they will do? And on the legal level, is it possible to talk with Russia on the basis, as you said, of international law, when they, from their perspective, they can overrule ECHR judgments when they deem it unconstitutional? And then a side question is whether you think this conflict is actually becoming frozen, or whether there will be any subsequent major developments?
It's possible on both scores. Whether it's likely or not is a different matter. Mr. Putin has ripped up the rule book, which effectively underpinned international order, and on which the post-Cold War order in Europe was based. And unless he's prepared to recognise once again that rule book, I think you make a very important point, which is it's not likely. But it is possible. On the military side, again, absolutely possible. And I think going back to my point about the lack of communication, pre-March 2014, the senior military in NATO were able to engage with and develop relationships with senior Russian military. I mean, General Gerasimov came to my house in Belgium when he visited Shape. I visited him in Moscow, and we were able to talk pretty frankly about some of the issues that were the concerns, and also some of the issues that were bedeviled the Russia-NATO relationship, not least ballistic missile defense. That all stopped after 2014, which I think is a matter of it's a matter of concern, because as long as you're talking, you can find ways to build relationships. If you're not talking, you don't build relationships. You then end up with misunderstandings and miscalculations. So I would, again, possible, but again, it's also the likelihood and the political challenge that makes it very difficult.
Person in the back.
Would you say that the Balkans could also be one of the most dangerous regions, potential conflict regions, and perhaps Putin might be wanting to stir up conflict there, based on the fact that he's encouraging Serbia and its claims to Kosovo and potentially was behind an attempted coup in Montenegro?
I wouldn't rule it out. I almost sort of take Russia out of the equation, and the Balkans, particularly Bosnia. I would say Bosnia is still in a. The conflict was frozen by Dayton, but all the old animosities and issues are just bubbling away below the surface, and we saw in 2013 with the outbreak of rioting and violence how very quickly things can flare up. And then add to that the potential advantages in strategic terms of that of Putin stirring things up or Russians stirring things up there. I think potential is always there. The one, and you mentioned Serbia. I mean, there is good news there, and I say the good news I would say is the fact that because of the magnet of the European Union. And some effective, very effective negotiations by Cathy Ashton, backed up by Hillary Clinton. Serbia and Kosovo signed a comprehensive normalisation agreement, which would have been unthinkable without the diplomatic and economic lure, as it were, of the European Union. How that's going, I'm not sure, but the fact that the Balkans is out of the headlines is an indication, actually, that things are probably not in a bad state. But we should never underestimate the potential of the Balkans to. Don't just assume that, particularly Bosnia, that we're home dry there, because we're not.
I'm afraid that's going to have to be the last question, because we have to be out of the room by 1 o'clock, and there are 4 minutes to go. Before I hand over to Lord Risby to give a formal vote of thanks, may I just add something into the debate, since NATO has been very much a focus of your comments, General. I had a discussion with the Prime Minister a couple of days ago, and we all know that she is heading to Washington as we speak, the first person to meet President Trump. And NATO very clearly is high on the Prime Minister's agenda. And I think that is very encouraging. I think it's also very encouraging that President Trump has appointed General Jim Mattis as his defense secretary, a man who has been completely unqualified in his support for NATO, and he is a man who comes with a very strong military track record. If I may hand over to Lord Risby.
Well, thank you. First of all, can I, on behalf of everybody, thank the Henry Jackson Society once again. They've had about 6 events this week in Parliament, and they bring so many fascinating speakers here, and it's been, again, a wonderful event and something which has been hugely stimulating and informative. I would just like to also add one other thing. We in this Parliament do more with Ukraine by far than any other Parliament on the planet. We've had a whole series of meetings this week, including with Ukrainian parliamentarians and the head of the Friendship Group and the Rada met Theresa May, actually personally, thanks to Sir Gerald. And this is absolutely our belief that we need to have a strong relationship with Ukraine. We're very keen to promote and encourage younger people involved in the life of Ukraine. And this is something we are absolutely committed to. But, Sir Rich, may I just thank you for a number of reasons. First of all, the sheer clarity of your presentation. We so often have people, if I may say so, come along who analyze the situation. You came up with some practical ideas, for example, on non-lethal provision, hugely important. And you also so correctly said that in the end, if there is a genuine settlement, and it's difficult to perceive it at this moment, with Russia on some proper existence, effective existence for Ukraine without what is going on, of course this is so vital to the interests of Ukraine and its prosperity and its ability to attract investment, which is crucial to the recovery of its economy. And I just think that, as you also correctly said, we have a new dynamic now in the form of a new president. And he will be looking at Russia in the context of the Middle East as well as Ukraine. And of course, what is so important is that at that crucial meeting, which will take place between our Prime Minister and President Trump, the issue of Ukraine will be high on the agenda. But thank you, and also for the British Ukrainian aid operation. There's more information in here. You don't have to pay 5 pence either to get the actually, again, the work that is done, because the number of displaced people, the people who've suffered horrible injuries, all these things perhaps escape our notice, and the fact that there is voluntary activity on so many levels. Thank you so much for a wonderful presentation, full of insight, and just to remind us how important Ukraine is on the international stage. Thank you.